With CAN results having been released and business schools having started releasing their interview calls, I'm sure all of you have started your preparation for the next round of selection process. The selection process at business schools invariably would comprise of a round on personal interviews. Now, this round becomes very crucial because most of the top business schools, they would give very high weightage to performance in personal interviews in their selection policy. In fact, places like IIM Ahmedabad, they go as high as 50% weightage to personal interview performance in their final selection policy. Now, I'm sure you would agree with me, any business school giving around 20%, 30%, 40% weightage to personal interviews, it basically means that everybody who would come for the next round of selection process has a very good chance of getting into the business school. The reason being, if a business school is giving high weightage to interviews, that means even if you have barely crossed the cutoff of that business school while securing an interview call, and even if that business school is considering your performance in CAT or performance in their any other entrance exam as part of the final selection policy also, you can compensate for not so great scores in entrance exam by putting in a very good performance in the other aspects of selection policy like written ability test, group discussion, and of course, personal interviews. In this webinar, I will take you through different aspects associated with personal interview preparation. At the end of the webinar, you would have a much better insight into how this process is conducted by business school and how exactly you need to perform in order to come out with flying colors. So let us get started, friends. The first and foremost question which a lot of people ask us is, what are personal interviews and why exactly are they conducted by business schools? Please understand, friends, when it comes to personal interviews, the basic reason for conducting them is business schools would like to select appropriate kind of students for their MBA program. I'm sure you would agree with me. MBA program is a program where a certain attributes must be there in a candidate. Only then that candidate would be suitable for this program. And only then this candidate would come out with flying colors, not only after passing through the MBA program, but also a few years down the line. So business schools are on lookout for people who have got those attributes. So personal interviews give them a golden opportunity to understand what kind of a person you are. What kind of traits do you possess? Interestingly, in personal interviews, they also get a chance to verify your claims while you were filling up GWPI forms of business schools. Now, I'm sure you must have observed, when business schools shortlist you, they give you forms to fill up. Now, while students fill up these forms, assuming that whatever they would write, probably a lot of the subjective part may not be verified by the professors. Now, this is a huge mistake that a lot of students commit. We strongly recommend that you be very sincere, you be very honest while filling up business school forms, because when it comes to personal interviews, professors do have the opportunity to verify your claims. This can be verified not just by verification of your documents, but also by asking you follow-up questions during an interview. They would also observe your body language while they are grilling you on any aspect that you might have claimed in your documents. So it makes sense to be very honest while you fill up business school forms and do not exaggerate your achievements. Friends, in a personal interview, typically you would have anywhere between 2 to 5 professors conducting the interviews. Even though I'm saying 2 to 5, majority of the business schools generally have 2 or 3 panelists on their interview panel. Now, who are these panelists? See, friends, these panelists could be professors of their business schools, HODs of their business school, or it can be director of their business school, dean of their business school, or it could as well be people from corporate world. Sometimes alumni of these business schools are also invited to conduct interviews for the business schools. Sometimes industry experts are also part of the panel which business schools make up for these interviews. But one thing is certain, when it comes to premier business schools of India, the quality of panelists would be very high. They are well-versed not only in corporate life and corporate culture, but they are also well-versed with respect to current affairs, general awareness, academic subjects. So they can talk about any issue and they can do it with an in-depth understanding of that particular issue. that is where it makes sense for you to go very good preparation for personal interviews. Friends, duration of interviews varies from person to person, interview to interview. But if you want a general idea about possible duration, I would say most of the interviews generally happen for anywhere between 10 to 20 minutes. There have been cases of interviews being performed for much longer duration as well. There have been cases of students getting interviewed even up to half an hour to an hour also. But those are aberrations. Most of the business schools typically have 10, 15, 20, 25 minutes of interviews. But one point I would like to illustrate here. The duration of your personal interview doesn't give you any kind of insight on your performance. It doesn't give you any kind of insight into your chances of getting selected in that business school. Please remember, sometimes professors, they run out of time also. Sometimes professors may have to interview a huge number of candidates within a single day. Sometimes professors may have to catch an evening flight also. So what they basically do is they shorten the length of the interview, but they do justice to every candidate. Based on their experience, based on their expertise, they are capable enough of selecting through the students within a short span of time also. So in case somebody who is watching this webinar, in case your interview happens to be for lesser duration, do not panic. These people are experts and these people would be very capable enough. They're very capable enough of identifying the right sort of a candidate within hardly a few minutes also. On the other hand, sometimes when the interview goes on for a very long time, again, you should not preempt the reason. There are two possibilities. Either they must have found you interesting, they might like to have a longer talk with you to understand you better. Or the other possibility, of course, sometimes could also be that the candidate might have said something, right? Candidate might have said something that they didn't like, and they would like to grill hard on that particular candidate and try to understand what was the motivation for that particular person's behavior or, you know, comments and so on and so forth. Therefore, do remember, duration of interviews is not the right way of gauging your performance. Whether you had a short interview or whether you had a long interview, invariably, it's your performance, it's your quality of answers, it's your quality of responses, it's quality of the behavior and attitude that you display through the interview that will decide whether you will make it in that process or not. Moving on, friends. Let's have a look at the types of interviews. See, broadly speaking, we can classify interviews into two types. You've got regular interviews, then you have got stress interviews. Friends, regular interviews are very common. Now, regular interviews are those kind of interviews where interviewer asks you a question, gives you ample amount of time to answer, doesn't demotivate you, doesn't discourage you. He listens to your answer and only then he asks you the next question and the interview progresses without much of stress factor. Wide majority of the students, they undergo regular interviews. But few students, they will also face the second type of interviews, what we call as stress interviews. As the name itself might have given you an idea, friends, stress interviews, they will subject you to a lot of stress and they would see how you deal with stress during the interview process. The question is, how will they create stress? Friends, creating stress is very simple for interviewers because majority of the students, when they enter into interview cabin, they're already nervous. So creating stress is not very difficult. There are so many ways of doing this. For instance, some interviewers, they create stress by asking rapid fire questions. Imagine I ask you a question. For instance, let's say I look at you and I ask you, why do you have less marks in engineering? And let us say you're answering my question. In a regular interview, typically I would listen to your answer. I will not discourage you. I would allow you to give whatever answer you want to give me. But in a stress interview, the interviewer, without waiting for you to finish your answer, while you are in the middle of your answer, he may immediately ask you something which is totally not related to this. For example, why do you have less marks in engineering? You're answering the question. I immediately ask you, who is Chief Minister of Mizoram? Now, from engineering low percentage to Chief Minister of Mizoram, obviously that will unsettle most of the interviewees. This is one way of creating stress. Another interesting way of creating stress is by giving an impression to the interviewee that you are not interested. Professors sometimes will show boredom on their faces during the interviews. Sometimes they will yawn in middle of the interview. Sometimes they will not listen to your answers. They will open their mobile phones and they may in fact play Candy Crush game on their mobiles. And they would play it in such a manner that the screen will be visible to you. Imagine if the interviewer is playing Candy Crush on his mobile phone, how would you feel? Obviously, you'll feel dejected. You'll feel demoralized because you would say, come on, yeah, I have traveled all the way from my hometown for this very important interview and you don't even have the courtesy to listen to my answers. Sometimes they open their newspapers and they start reading in the middle of the interview. Now, these are all tricks that they use to give an impression to the interviewee that they're not interested. But the fact is, this professor who is giving an impression of playing a video game or reading a newspaper, this person is all ears. This person is listening to your answers with 100% concentration. But if he behaves like this, then obviously the confidence levels of people will go for a toss. Now, in case of harsh stress interviews, sometimes professors, they also may end up passing an odd remark here and there to unsettle you. For example, in one case, professor kept on asking questions on academic-related subjects, and the candidate was not able to answer most of the questions. So he wanted to unsettle the student, so he looked at the student and said, are you really an engineer? Have you really finished your engineering program? Now, if a professor passes a remark like this, obviously it creates stress even for the most toughest of the candidates. So these are some ways of creating stress, my friend. But do remember this. If professor is creating stress in the interview room and if he's subjecting you to stress, please do remind yourself. What you need to remind yourself, my friend, is this is just a drama. This is just an acting. This is an act that the professor is putting up. This professor doesn't hate you. This professor doesn't have any kind of enmity with you. He is just a professional who is doing his job to find out the most suitable candidates for MBA program of his or her business school. Now comes the million-dollar doubt. Sir, how do I win in a stress interview? How do I come out with flying colors in a stress interviews? Friends, it's not very difficult. It's not very difficult if you know the approach. Friends, the approach that you should take in stress interview is you need to exhibit excellent attitude throughout the interview. Remember, in a stress interview, quality of your answers are secondary. Your attitude, your behavior is the first and foremost thing that the interviewer is observing. You are judged mostly on the basis of your attitude in stress interviews. Even if quality of your answers are not great, but your attitude is awesome, then definitely will impress the professor. Now, what kind of attitude should I exhibit? I would say, friends, there are two mistakes that you should definitely avoid in a stress interview. Mistake number one, you should never, ever give symptoms or signs of giving up. If you allow the interviewer to get a feeling that you are uncomfortable and you're not able to manage the stress and you're on the verge of giving up, my friend, it will be game over for you. Now, how do we give a sign or a symptom? What are the symptoms that we exhibit when we become uncomfortable and we are on the verge of giving up? What are the symptoms? Symptom number one, of course, you avoid eye contact with the interviewer because you're uncomfortable. Symptom number two, people, their body language will become defensive. They will start leaning forward. They will start sweating. Even the fluent speakers, they start stammering. And sometimes when the stress goes to the next level, sometimes people even stop answering questions. They will look down and they'll not answer at all. That, of course, is like raising a white color flag in the middle of the interview and saying, I give up. In rare cases, some people who are very sensitive, they even break down in the middle of the interview. Please do remember, never do this. Because obviously by doing this, what you are showing to the interviewer is you are incapable of taking stress. Please remember, you are applying for MBA program. MBA program requires students who are capable enough of managing stress. Remember, in future, when you take up a managerial role, you will do a lot of multitasking. Most of the roles will include client relationship aspect also. Some of the clients will be very demanding. And in that particular situation, a lot of stress gets created, my friend. Now, they want to select students who are capable of managing stress. So never show them signs that you are not capable of managing stress. Now, the question that people often ask me, then what do I do? How do I show to him that I'm not giving up? Do I actually say it explicitly? Do I look at the professor in the middle of the interview and say, excuse me, sir, I don't give up? Do you have to say that? Obviously not. You have to convey it in a very implicit manner. How do we convey it to professor that we are capable of managing stress? Simple answer is, have positive body language throughout the interview. Have a pleasant expression on your face. Right? Maintain eye contact with the interviewers without any fear. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not asking you to stare at the interviewers. But then maintain friendly, confident eye contact with the interviewers. Next, of course, friends, don't show fear on your face. Don't stop answering the question. Remember, they may cut you short. They may not allow you to finish your answers. But if they do that, don't worry, go ahead and answer the next question that they have posed. Keep on answering without any break in middle passage. Of course, you can think for a couple of seconds before you answer, which is absolutely fine, which is good. But don't give up. That's what is very important. But the second part is also very crucial. Second mistake that you should avoid when you undergo a stress interview, friends. Some people become angry. One extreme is giving up, but the other extreme is losing your cool and acting like a rebel in the middle of the interview. Some students do that. When they are subjected to a lot of stress, some people lose their cool. Sometimes they say some things which are very demeaning. In fact, I remember there was one student, when he was subjected to stress interview, in the middle of the interview, he looked at the panel and he said, excuse me, you are asking so many questions to me. Can I ask a question to you? Obviously, if you say that, it's like almost as if you're not committing suicide in the middle of the interview. It'll be game over for you as such. So do remember, do not misbehave with the panel. Do not be impolite with the panel. Because if you do that, you are only ruining your chances. Again, how to do that? How to go about doing this? How do I show to the panel that I'm a very polite person? See, you exhibit politeness by using polite language. You exhibit politeness by never ever shouting at the panel or raising your volume beyond the volume of the panel. You show politeness by never interrupting the panel. You should always remember, when the interviewer opens his mouth, when the interviewer is speaking, you have to remain silent. By doing this, you give an impression to the panel that you are a very, very polite person. So politeness along with confidence is the secret of winning in a stress interview. If you ask me, friends, stress interviews are actually easy kind of interviews, provided you are well prepared for these kind of interviews. Now, one question that all the students would have in their minds, I'm sure, is how do I prepare for this? See, one thing, of course, is you have to mentally be ready for this. But the other aspect is getting practical exposure. Best way of doing this is when you attend mock interview classes, if you have registered for GWP program at time, when you will attend mock interview classes, I'm pretty much sure you will undergo all different types of interviews in time. Few mock interviews in time with experts of time, I'm pretty much sure you will come out with flying colors as far as attitude part is concerned. I have absolutely no doubt in my mind. Those of you who are watching this webinar who have not registered for GWPI program, you too can register for GWPI program if you've got a call from a business school. And definitely attend mock PI sessions so that you get this kind of exposure and this kind of practical demonstration of how these interviews are done. So these are broadly speaking two types of interviews. But friends, let me add one important word out here. Sometimes people undergo very friendly interviews also. Sometimes interviewers are very, very friendly. Remember, these interviewers are very dangerous. Because if any interviewer is behaving in an extremely friendly manner, sometimes students, they lose control over their tongue. They end up revealing stuff which they ideally speaking should never reveal in interview. For example, there was one particular student. The interviewer behaved in a very friendly manner with this person. And this faculty member, this professor, started giving compliments to the student, especially with respect to her engineering subject knowledge. So professor looks at the student and says, hey, you have got excellent knowledge of engineering. I'm very glad that India has got girls like you who are this much competent in engineering subjects. And the professor looks at the girl and says, my dear, you know what? A girl like you deserves to go to America and do your MS from a leading university in America in engineering field. The girl loved this compliment. The student loved this compliment. She looked at the professor and she said, actually, ma'am, what you're saying is true. I've already written GRE and TOEFL. I've got a call from a university and I'm just waiting for my interview at US consulate. The professor gave a beautiful smile. Why did professor smile? Because professor understood that MBA is not this girl's first preference. My friend, if anybody gets a feeling that MBA is not your first preference, your first love, your first preference is something else, MBA is just a backup option for you in life, then obviously you would not be the preferred student for the panel. Because panel would say, for you, this is not a passion. So therefore, you may not turn out to be an ideal student, a good student of MBA program. So friendly interviewers, whenever you meet them, you have to be at your guard. You should talk to yourself in your mind and remind yourself, this is not my uncle, this is not my aunt. He is just a professional who is doing his job. And I have to be on my guard and I have to be very careful about what I reveal to him or her during the interview as such. So these are different types of interviews, friends. Let's move on. What are the different type of questions that these professors will ask you during interviews? There are many types. Let us look at the major type of questions. I will also take one or two sample questions for each of these types. Now, the first type that I would like to discuss are questions which are introduction related. Now, usually these questions, they are asked at the beginning part of the interview. Now, what kind of questions would they ask? For example, professor would look at you and sometimes ask questions like, tell me something about yourself. Or professor may say, hey, what is your name? And let's say you say, sir, my name is Roshni. Professor would say, okay, Roshni, what is the meaning of Roshni? Do you relate to this meaning? Why do you think your parents named you Roshni as such? What could have been the reason? Or questions could be about the kind of person you are. A question could be, if I go and approach your friend and ask your friend to describe you as a person, what do you think your friend will tell me regarding you as such? These are all introduction-related questions. But the most important question that you need to be prepared for is, tell me something about yourself. A lot of students, they don't really understand how to tackle this particular question. A lot of students, they ask questions and about, you know, what should be the thinking process? What should I think when I frame an answer for this question? See, I would say this is a golden opportunity for you to impress the professor. Remember, first impression is the best impression, and usually in interviews, this usually is the first question that they would ask. So tell me something about yourself. You have a golden opportunity, one, to impress the professor, and two, to try to set an agenda for this particular interview. Because most of the times, whatever you talk about as part of your answer for this question, sometimes that could be the basis on which further questions would be asked by the panel. So what you need to do, my friend, is include all the attractive things that you have got in your profile. Try to impress the panel by highlighting to them indirectly that you are the right candidate for the program. So for example, what can you include as part of your answer? You can talk about your academic background. In fact, go into depths of academic background if your academic background is very strong and if you are somebody who is interested in panel asking you a lot of questions on ACATS. You can talk about paper presentations that you might have done in various places. You could talk about excellent ranks that you might have secured. You can talk about internships that you might have done as part of your education, right? You can talk about all the aspects, all the attractive things associated with your academics, if you have got those kind of aspects. Apart from this, let us say there is somebody who is watching this webinar whose academic profile is not very attractive. Do not be disheartened, my friend. I'm sure there are other attractive things about you. For example, your hobbies may be very interesting, right? The stuff that you do in free time, positive activities that you undertake during free time, you can definitely talk about those activities. But then my suggestion to you, friends, is do not make it as if you are reading from your resume. Don't go bullet point wise. Some people, they just say things like, my hobby is to paint. I love reading novels, full stop. I mean, this is not how you frame your answer. You make it in a more conversational manner. Sir, during my free time, I read novels. I especially love novels written by Jane Austen. What I like about this particular author is the way she expresses her ideas. It takes me to a different era altogether. I love reading novels written by her. So if you explain your hobby in this manner, then obviously the interviewer would love it. An interviewer is bound to ask you a lot of questions on one, Jane Austen, the author, the books that she has written, the characters that she has portrayed, and of course, any kind of controversies associated with those kind of books as such. So if you are prepared, if you have preempted that these questions would come your way, then all the more reason for you to talk about this. Some of you may be into sports. Some of you may have done a lot of cultural activities in your college. You can talk about those. Now, people who have got work experience who are watching this particular webinar, you can talk about your work ex also. But again, don't just talk about name of the company, industry, and number of months of work ex. Please expand. Add two or three sentences there. For example, you can say what your role is. You can talk about any major achievement you had at workplace. Some of you may have won awards like Best Employee of the Week or Month or Quarter, right? Some of you may have got a lot of appreciation mails from clients also, right? So you can talk about those also. Basically, try and sell yourself as part of your answer for this particular question. You can also include information about attractive personality traits that you possess. Some of you may have very good leadership ability. Some of you may have a lot of patience. Some of you may have the ability to meet deadlines that you have exhibited in your life so far. So whatever attractive traits you have got, even those can be included as part of tell me something about yourself. Only word of caution from my side would be try and avoid speaking negatively about yourself. Don't unnecessarily reveal negative aspects about your profile as part of tell me something about yourself. Of course, if they ask about those things explicitly, you have to be honest, you have to speak about those. But voluntarily, don't end up talking negatively about yourself, especially as part of tell me something about yourself answer. Friends, everybody who's watching this webinar, do study about your name also. You should be aware of meaning of your name. If there was any famous person who has got the same name as you, you should be ready to take questions of that famous person. If there is any mythological story or any particular incident in the history associated with your name, you please be ready to take questions on them. For example, we once had a student. Student's name was Gautam. Now, obviously, if your name is Gautam, professor is bound to ask you questions on Gautam Buddha. Now, that student was very well prepared and he could take questions very easily. That is what will impress the professor. So you have to be well versed with respect to that also. Moving on, friends. The second type of questions are personality related questions. See, personality related questions would be questions which talk about your personality traits. For example, what are your strengths? Hey, when did you identify your strength? How did you identify your strength? Hey, can you tell me an incident from your life where your strength has helped you out? Similarly, what is your weakness? Right? Or a question could be, what are your hobbies? What do you do in your free time? Who is your role model in life? These are all questions which are probing the kind of person you are. Now, it makes sense for you to do a little bit of homework. What are your strengths? Strengths are positive traits that you may have. Strengths are those traits which help you in being a good student, in being a good employee, in being a good family member, and so on. Please take a piece of paper whenever you're free and jot down what are the good things about you. Some people, they approach the faculty members in time and ask them, can you tell me what are my strengths? Now, we can't tell you this because we don't know you the way your parents know you as such. Of course, sometimes you may have been in touch with a faculty member for a slightly longer period. Then, of course, the faculty would surely be able to help you. But if you're meeting a faculty for the first time, then it doesn't make sense to ask this question to faculty. It makes sense to go to your mother, go to your father, and of course, take the help. After you ask your mother, mother, what is good about me? But if mother takes a lot of time to answer, don't get annoyed. It could be just that mother is thinking of so many good virtues that you've got that probably she's just wondering which virtues to highlight. So try and note down all the good things that your mother highlights about you. And then from those good qualities of yours, decide which ones you want to reveal in interview. I would recommend pick up those virtues, pick up those positive traits where you are ready to take follow-up questions. Questions like, when did you identify your strength? Now remember, strengths are usually exhibited right from childhood itself. Similarly, pick up those strengths where you may have an incident to share with the panel where your strength has helped you out. So a lot of homework also needs to be done with respect to each of these answers. The next question usually unsettles most of the candidates. What is your weakness? Before that, professor may look at you and say, do you have a weakness? Majority of the candidates immediately, they say, no, no, sir, I don't have any weakness. But think about it. Can there be a human being who doesn't have a weakness? Every single human being on planet Earth has weakness. If anybody claims they don't have weakness, either they are lying or they are hiding the truth. No professor will trust this answer. The mature answer, the right answer always is, reveal your genuine weakness, but preferably reveal those weaknesses which can be worked upon, which can be improved upon. Those kind of weaknesses you should reveal in interview, but genuine weakness. Some students, they ask me, sir, can't I talk about my strength and label it as my weakness? Lot of books available in market on personal interviews, they unfortunately mislead people into believing this. Please remember, never do this. If you go to an interview, talk about your strength and label it as your weakness, trust me, professors who are conducting these interviews are extremely experienced lot. They will look through your answer, and what will invariably happen is you will lose trust of the panel. That is not what you want to do, isn't it? You want to earn that trust. You want to retain that trust. For that to happen, my friend, you have to be honest. Be honest. Don't be afraid. Share your weakness. But do remember, share only those weaknesses which can be worked upon and improved upon. Some people ask me, for example, now, I'm going to share an example, but you better not copy this answer, right? We have to be honest. You have to do a little bit of soul searching and then come up with a genuine answer of your own. I'll give you one example, though. For example, one of the students once told me, sir, my weakness is I get impatient. I become impatient, sir. Impatience is my weakness, sir. But I'm working on it. I asked the student, hey, how are you working on it? What are you doing? She said, sir, nowadays I'm indulging in activities which require a lot of patience. I was curious. I asked, what type of activities are you referring to? She said, sir, nowadays I'm making breakfast for all my family members. I'm making 25 chapatis in morning. Sir, I'm not using ATM cards, sir. I'm going to government bank. I'm standing in a queue with 20, 25 members for an hour and withdrawing my check, withdrawing money from bank. I'm babysitting for my nephew, sir. Now, these are activities that definitely will improve the patient levels in a person as well. These kind of answers, what happens is you retain the trust of the panel, and also the panel would believe that you are a mature person because you're not only identifying your weaknesses, but you're working towards improvement. This, my friend, would be an irresistible quality that a student can have as far as business schools are concerned. Similarly, professors can also ask you questions on hobbies. Now, what are hobbies? Hobbies are those activities that we undertake in our free time about which we have got loads and loads of patience, loads and loads of passion. You should have a lot of passion towards those activities. But they can ask you questions on hobbies. For example, people generally say cricket is their hobby. Now, remember, they can ask you a lot of questions on cricket. Be prepared for taking questions on cricket. For example, professor can look at you and say, okay, so can you tell me what are the rules associated with LBW? Now, remember, there are multiple rules. There are multiple rules associated with LBW. As a cricket fan, as a cricket lover, you should be aware of those rules. Right? So whatever your hobby is, please be prepared to take a lot of questions regarding those hobbies. The next question, of course, who is your role model in life? Do you have a role model in life? Now, a lot of students invariably, they say, I don't have a role model. Now, nothing wrong with this answer, except for the fact that business school professors, they believe, right? Most of the professors, they believe that students with role models, students who have got role models, the chance that they would succeed in life will be much higher. So if you say, I don't have a role model, most of the professors would not like this. So what you need to do, my friend, is if you don't have a role model, at least say your parents are your role model. Right? I'm sure there are a lot of qualities in your parents that you respect, that you like, that you admire. That is what a role model should have, isn't it? So if you say your parents are your role model, your brother is your role model, sister is your role model, And if you can take questions on those, it'll be good for you as such. And I'm sure you would agree with me, your parents, your siblings, I'm sure they have a lot of good qualities in them that you admire and that you wish that you also should ask, you should try and get those qualities in yourself also. That person could be a role model. But do remember, role model need not always be an anonymous person. Role model can be a famous person also. For example, some people can say Mahatma Gandhi is their role model. Mother Teresa is their role model. APJ Abdul Kalam is their role model. Or say Sachin Tendulkar is their role model. These answers are also fine. But the challenge here is professor would know these persons. So professor will ask you a lot of questions on these persons. And you should be able to answer those questions. But I'm pretty much sure if you are a genuine fan of Sachin Tendulkar, you will be capable enough of taking questions on Sachin. Only suggestion from my side would be, try and avoid giving negative characters as role model. Don't end up saying things like, Adolf Hitler is my role model, for example. These kind of answers are absolutely ridiculous. It can embarrass you a lot in interviews. Never give negative characters as role models. Moving on, friends. The third type of questions that professors ask in interviews are career-related questions. Now, career-related questions would be something like, why do you want to do MBA program? Where do you see yourself a few years down the line? Right? These are the kind of questions that they ask to ascertain what kind of career goals you have got, what kind of path you would like to undertake in your future. That's the whole agenda here. But the most important question would be, why do you want to make a career in management? Why do you want to do MBA program? Friends, this question can be answered in multiple ways. For example, you can talk about how you developed interest towards MBA in the first place. That could be one interesting point to share with the panel. Now, different people will have different trigger points. Some of you who may be freshers, you may have done a lot of work in college, which involved leadership role, which involved team working aspect. And you may have enjoyed those kind of inputs, those kind of jobs. And that may have propelled an interest in you to pursue an MBA program. You may have started believing that you are good enough to be a manager. And you started believing that MBA is your calling. So you can talk about the trigger point. For example, those of you are working class and you have got good amount of work experience, 2 years, 2.5, 3.5 years of experience. Obviously, you would have exposure at workplace. Maybe you may have realized that the managerial role is what attracts you. You may have taken managerial role either in informal or formal manner, and you may have performed well, or you may have felt the need of more awareness and knowledge. You may have believed that your knowledge about how business functions is extremely limited, and you may believe that a formal education is the way forward for you to get a larger perspective about how business functions. That could be the trigger point. But do remember, when you are giving this answer, you should always highlight your goals, your short-term professional goal as well as long-term professional goal, and then explain how MBA will help you in reaching those goals in life. Remember, MBA is not the goal. Many people say, my goal in life is to do MBA. Now, that cannot be your goal. MBA is just a path. It takes you towards your goals as such. So say, I want to do MBA. As in the short term, I want to do this. In the long term, I want to do this. And I believe MBA will help me in reaching those goals. We can make an answer in and around this also. But this particular answer would require a little bit of effort from your side. You have to do a little bit of preparation of your own. Only then you will be ready to give an answer on the day of interview as such. Moving on, friends. The next category of questions are academic subject related questions. Now, these questions are usually asked to people who either have no experience or they have got relatively lesser amount of experience. Now, what do I mean by relatively lesser amount of work experience? Usually people who have got less than 2, 2.5 years of experience, they usually are grilled or hard on academics. Having said that, let me also confess that there have been cases of people with more than 3 years experience who have also been grilled on academics. But then the expectation of the panel would be very high, especially if you don't have experience or you have got relatively less amount of experience. Now, what kind of questions can they ask? They can ask you both theoretical questions as well as practical questions. Those of you who have registered for GWPI program in time, refer to GWPI briefcase link, which must be available on your student homepage. That would contain a lot of academic questions for your preparation. Do ensure that you don't just limit yourself to those questions, but also expand your knowledge by covering related stuff also. You should at least be good with basics. Now, what kind of questions can they ask? Let's take a small example. Let's say somebody is an electrical engineer or a mechanical engineer. Now, professor can look at you in the middle of the interview and say, so can you tell me what is zeroth law of thermodynamics? This could be a question, theoretical question. But sometimes they may ask a practical question also. A mechanical engineer can be asked this question. Professor would say, okay, can you tell me every morning when I'm kick-starting my bike, the first set of smoke that comes out in early morning is white in color. It's only after some time it turns into black. Hey, what's the reason behind this? Or professor can simply look at the student and say, hey, can you tell me what's the difference between two-stroke bike and a four-stroke bike? A mechanical engineer is supposed to know all this. So these are the kind of questions professor would ask. Please remember, friends, you have to be very honest in an interview when it comes to any question, more so in case of academic questions. If you don't know the answer, accept your ignorance. There is nothing wrong in saying, I don't know, or I'm unable to recall. You can say that without any hesitation. But if you are not certain, if you're having a bit of idea and you would still like to answer, you can ask the permission of the panel. You can say, sir, I'm not sure of it, but I would like to still answer. Is it okay with you, sir? And then give your answer. The next type of questions professor can ask you are general awareness and current affairs related questions. Now here, I would say broadly, there are two types of questions. Questions can be either subjective in nature or objective in nature. Objective questions usually are those which have only one correct answer. For example, who is Vice President of India? Who is Governor of your state? These are objective type questions. A subjective question could again be of two types. Subjective question means a question which has got longer answer, lengthier answer, right? And then these kind of questions could be of two types. A question could be very, very a simple question which is not controversial at all. For example, something like, can you tell me how is President of India elected? Now, this question is not at all controversial. There is one correct way of answering it, and you can go ahead and you can talk about the process of electing President of India. On the other hand, sometimes subjective questions can be little uncomfortable also. Questions which are little controversial in nature. For example, a question in interview could also be something like, what is your opinion about reservation policy of Government of India? Right? When these kind of questions are asked, you have to be very careful. Remember, friends, any question which is little controversial and so on and so forth, you have to be a little careful. When I'm using the word controversial, I'm just looking at it from your perspective, a question which will make you a little uncomfortable. That's what I mean by that. When it comes to these kind of questions, what I suggest is take a middle path. Just analyze the situation. Don't take stand on these kind of issues. The best way of answering this question is you simply say, sir, there are both advantages and disadvantages of this. Highlight all the advantages, highlight all the disadvantages. Just analyze the problem. There is absolutely no need to take any kind of stand on this. Remember, professor is not bothered about the stand. Professor is only asking these kind of questions to ascertain what is your ability of analysis. If you can analyze any of these kind of problems, it is good enough for professor. But do work on your current affairs knowledge, especially the major events which may have happened in India in the last 1 year. Do prepare on those events. Not only gathering facts and figures, but also you should develop the ability to analyze the situation. For example, an interview question could be, hey, how is India doing economically speaking? If I ask you this question in interview, you should first share facts and figures with me. You should tell me what is our GDP growth rate, right? In past, what was our GDP growth rate? How does it compare to the rest of the countries? Then, of course, what are the challenges that economy faces? What about GST collection? What about this? What about that? You should be able to analyze it in detail. Then professor would be impressed. Friends, the next category of questions are morals and ethical-based questions, ethics-based questions. Moral and ethic-based questions basically ascertain, are you a good human being or are you not a good human being? Are you a good citizen of India or are you not a good citizen of India? This is the whole motive behind asking questions on morals and ethics. For example, professor can simply look at you and say, questions like, let's say you're traveling in a bus. He will draw a hypothetical scenario. Question could be, you're traveling in a bus. And you forgot the ticket at home. And imagine you don't have mobile phone, you don't have any proof that you have purchased the ticket. And now the TC gives you two options. He says, pay 500 rupee challan or you pay 100 rupee bribe. What would you prefer to do? Would you pay 100 rupee bribe or would you like to pay 500 rupee challan? Obviously, these kind of questions are trying to ascertain what kind of ethics you have got. The right answer, the ideal answer, of course, is I will not pay a single paisa bribe. I don't mind paying 500 rupee challan, but I'll not pay a single paisa as corruption. Right? This will prove to the professor that here is an ethical person. Here is somebody who, if selected, will not bring bad reputation to the institute few years down the line. Right? Never ever take a stand which goes against ethics and morals. The next category of question I've written there, miscellaneous. Now, miscellaneous would refer to all the other type of questions. For example, sometimes professors will ask you puzzle to solve. If a puzzle is being asked, remember, giving the right answer is secondary. The analysis, the problem solving approach is what is primary. So even if you are unable to give the answer, not a problem, but try and attempt. Don't give up. People who give up when they are asked puzzles, hardly within few seconds, professors don't like them because they don't have the ability to take a problem head on. Try it for some time and try with logic, try it with reasoning. Even then, if you're not getting the answer, it's absolutely fine. Nobody would know answer for everything. But the attitude that you need to exhibit in interview should be positive attitude. You should come across as somebody who can face absolutely unsurmountable challenge and still not give up and take it head on. Those are the people who have a very good chance of becoming successful managers in future. Miscellaneous also would refer to some questions on whatever you speak, whatever you say, it can lead to some miscellaneous follow-up questions. For example, somebody says, sir, I love singing. Professor can look at you and say, okay, why don't you sing a song? Then you better sing a song because you claim you love singing. Now, when you pick up a song, it goes without saying, it should be a good choice. Pick up something that can be translated in English without any embarrassment. Pick up something which is very melodious and which is not very, very, you know, superficial. Pick up something with good meanings, good lyrics, so that if you ask to convert them, translate them, it should show to professor that you are into something which is more meaningful. Sometimes they would ask questions out of the blue also. Questions for which you are not prepared. Questions that you might not have come across in your life. Questions which will make you feel a little surprised. For example, somebody can look at you and say, so in which year were you born? And you say, sir, I was born in 1996. Professor can look at you and say, okay, so one good thing that happened in 1996 where you were born. Apart from this, can you tell me anything else that happened in 1996? Now, this question is something which will make you a little uncomfortable because you never thought about it. At that time, friends, don't give up. Tell to the professor, sir, do you mind if I think for some time? Right? Think for a few seconds. And I'm sure if you think hard, you can think of some event that might have happened in 1996. For example, if you think for a few seconds, suddenly you realize, hey, come on, Cricket World Cup happened in 1996. And then you look at the professor and say, I guess Cricket World Cup happened in 1996, sir. And so-and-so team won the World Cup. That'll be good enough. That shows your presence of mind, right? So questions which are absolutely not prepared for, if they come your way, don't give up. Think and attempt those questions. All right? So these are various types of questions that they can ask in personal interviews. Now, some important do's and don'ts that I want to discuss with you, friends. Let's start with the dress code. What is it that we need to wear for personal interviews? Friends, boys and girls will have different dress code. Let's start with boys, right? Let's start with boys. As far as boys are concerned, you don't have choice. You can only wear a formal trouser and a formal shirt for personal interview. What's a formal trouser? What's a formal shirt? See, usually plain color trouser, plain color shirt is referred to as formal, but it should be of contrasting colors. So dark color trouser and light color shirt or vice versa is preferable. Having said that, some experts, they are of the opinion that shirts with stripes, especially if stripes are very minute in nature, some experts believe that's also formal a shirt as such. But then old school people, they are firm believers that plain color shirt should be preferred. So it's up to you what you want to decide. But if you want to be very safe, prefer plain color shirt and a plain color trouser of contrasting colors. It goes without saying, boys should tuck in their shirt, wear a belt, and wear full sleeve shirt, button it up, and have regular collars. Don't wear Chinese collars. Chinese collar shirts are not considered formal. Some students, they ask me, sir, should I wear a tie also? Tie is optional. Now, having said that, if you know how to tie a knot, if you can wear a formal tie, trust me, it'll add a lot of value to your personality. Especially in business schools, if you go wearing a tie, which is a formal tie, it adds a lot of value to your personality. If you don't believe me, since all of us love selfies, take a couple of selfies of yourself. One without tie, one with tie. Trust me, you yourself would be able to see a remarkable difference in your personality. But then the magic here is, the important point here is, you should know how to tie the knot. A lot of us, we take help from our friends and family members when we need to tie the knot. That is not a good habit. I had a student once, he went for an interview. In middle of the interview, professor got up. He approached the student, removed the tie, went back to his chair, sat in it, threw the tie at the student and said, "Why didn't you tie it?" Now, you can't look at the professor and say, "Sorry, sir, my father did not come along with me into the interview cabin." You cannot say that, right? You should know how to tie the knot. What about blazer? Should I wear a blazer for interview? See, blazer is optional, absolutely optional. It's not mandatory. You don't have to go to a shop or a showroom and purchase a blazer for 10,000 rupees. If you own one and if you are comfortable wearing one, and more importantly, if your blazer is formal, then definitely you can wear it without any problem. But then also take into consideration the weather in your city, because if your interview is happening somewhere in March and April, right? India, especially in those parts of India which are very hot and humid, then probably you may be uncomfortable wearing a blazer. So in that particular situation, it makes sense. Even if you want to wear one, it makes sense to carry your blazer in a cover, right? Suit cover, blazer cover. And then, of course, wear it only when you are inside the hotel, which hopefully would be a 3-star or a 5-star hotel, and it'll have centralized air condition in it. So this is for boys. And of course, I'm not going to go into details of, you know, grooming aspects and so on and so forth. I'm assuming here everybody is familiar with how to groom themselves. You have to be presentable. You should not look as if you are a rebel who has got a course to take up when they come to a business school. Be very presentable. Look like a good, suitable student when you go for interviews. Now, moving on to girls. Girls who are watching this video, you have choice. You can either go with Indian wear or you can go with Western wear. As far as Western wear is concerned, you can wear a suit, a trouser, shirt and a suit. That is one option for you. The other option for you, of course, is you can go for an Indian wear. In Indian wear, again, you have got options. You can either go with a sari. Yes, sari is considered to be the most formal Indian dress. But if you opt for a sari, remember, what kind of sari am I talking about? I'm talking about a sari that usually Air India air hostesses wear. Right? A cotton sari with a single color and single color border, that is considered to be formal for girls. If you're not comfortable in a sari, then the other option for you is to wear salwar kameez. Again, if you're picking up a salwar kameez for interview, it should be a very simple salwar kameez without much of, you know, embroidery, zardozi work, mirror work and so on and so forth. Very simple, elegant, professional looking salwar kameez is what you need to wear for interviews. And girls, please pick up good footwear for yourself, right? Don't wear worn out old kind of footwear. Wear very good footwear when you go for interviews. Now, what to carry along? What should I have along with me? When you go for interviews, friends, please buy a good folder first of all. Don't buy the cheap folder that we generally carry when we go for our college viva. Buy a folder with a zipper and which preferably should be able to take onslaught of weather also. It should not cause any kind of problem if rainfall happens. And then if your certificates get drenched, it can cause a lot of problem for you. So therefore, it makes sense to have a folder which is waterproof. And then folder should also have different containers, different segments into it, wherein you should be able to arrange all the documents properly. In middle of the interview, if the interviewer looks at you and asks for a document, you should be able to take it out without any hesitation, without any waste of time. That shows that you have come prepared for the interview. Now, what should you carry along in that particular folder? Friends, first and foremost, you must have a call letter from the business school. If at all your business school has given a call letter, take a printout of it, carry it along. You should also carry along with you your CAT scorecard. It makes sense to carry along with you your academic certificates. So most of these business schools will ask you to carry original certificates along with you for verification. Remember, when you filled up CAT form, you might have filled up so many details. All those details may be verified when you go there for interviews. So academic certificates, extracurricular certificates should also be carried along. few blank papers can also be carried along so that if they ask you to solve a mathematical problem, if they ask you to solve a puzzle, you can always ask them, sir, can I write it on a piece of paper? Can I work it out on a piece of paper? Take that piece of paper and work it out. You can also carry, and in fact, you should also carry a pen, which writes, of course. You should have a pen in working condition along with you so that you can work it out if need be. Right? You carry all these things along with you in a decent folder, formal folder, when you go for interview as such. Friends, when the interview process begins, when you enter into the cabin, please make sure you maintain good decorum. So when you enter into the cabin, knock on the door. If the door is semi-open or the door is closed, knock on the door. Or just look inside, greet the panel, ask their permission when you walk inside. Once they permit you to come inside, you walk inside, greet them. Always use formal greeting. Say, good morning, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Good evening, sir, depending on time of the day. Don't use informal greeting. Never say hi, hello kind of greeting should not be used with professors. Formal greeting. When you walk inside, don't directly grab the chair and sit. Right? Usually, professors would give you permission to sit. Professors will say, why don't you sit, please? Say, thank you, sir, and then be seated. If they don't give you permission, just stand for 2-3 seconds and ask their permission. Sir, may I take my seat? They would say, yes. And say, thank you, and then be seated. When you sit, you may should ensure that you sit properly, right? Sit properly, sit confidently. Don't keep your belongings on the adjacent chair. Your folder should be on your laps. Don't keep anything on the table. Remember, the table belongs to the interviewer. So keep your belongings on your lap. Sit confidently out there. Now let's shift our focus to verbal communication that happens during the interview. Remember, you should be audible to the panel. Don't whisper. Neither should you shout. You should speak at an optimum level and modulate your voice. Do not be monotonous, right? Do not be monotonous. Modulate your voice during the interview. A verbal communication also, you should remember, you should not use informal language. A lot of students have this habit of using terms like, yeah. When the professor asks the question immediately, yeah, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. Yeah is informal. You should always say yes. Or people generally say, my mom, my dad in the middle of the interview. Remember, it's always my mother, my father. Right? Formal language is what you need to use in interview as such. Next, try and stick to English. Don't use your mother tongue in interview. The entire interview, try and answer every question in formal English language. Now, some people who may be watching this webinar, if at all you are one of those students who have a tendency of committing grammatical mistakes, let me tell you this. No professor would reject you just because you are committing grammatical errors. Professors, they give a lot of respect to quality of ideas. Professors, they give a lot of importance to confidence levels. Professors give a lot of importance to attitude of the candidate. Your grammatical skills will be secondary. Your confidence and your personality is of primary importance to the professor. So I always say to my students, if you are committing mistakes, at least ensure you do those with confidence, right? When it comes to grammatical mistakes. Remember, somebody like Virender Singh Sehwag, for example, when Sehwag used to get Man of the Match award at Lord's, right? When he used to speak in English, he used to commit grammatical mistakes. But nobody bothered. Nobody used to make fun of him because he used to speak with a lot of confidence. That is what you need to exhibit during your interview. Next, friends, body language. You have to exhibit positive body language. When you sit in front of the professors, keep your feet on the ground. Have your knees closely drawn to each other. Sit straight in an interview. Right? Do not bend forward. Don't lean back also. Sit in comfortable posture, straight posture. And remember, maintain eye contact with all the interviewers. If there are two or three professors, one of them is asking the question, start by looking at that professor, but then very quickly look at the other professors also when you are answering the question. Right? Next aspect of body language, friends, try and avoid having too much of hand gestures. Your hand gestures, if you use too much of them, then it becomes distracting for the panel. Panel should focus on your answer. Panel should not stare at your hands alone. That means I'm not asking you to behave like a statue. I'm just saying move your hands, but not too much. Excessive hand gestures should be avoided. The next point, friends, you have to be polite with the panel. See, there will be times, if you observe, one more point is how to disagree with the panel if needed. See, politeness and this question, this point, let me club them. Sometimes panel may say something that you don't agree with. You have to be very polite when you disagree with the panel. For example, let's say one of the panelists looks at you and says, why do you have less marks in BTEC? Now you're answering, you're saying, sir, actually, what happened was I was not well during exams and blah, 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 whatever your answer is. Let's say one of the panelists looks at you and says, hey, come on, don't cook up stories. I know you are a lazy person who didn't work hard during exams. Admit it. Were you not a lazy person? Are you not a lazy boy? Obviously, you should not agree with the panel and say, yes, sir, you have correctly identified me. You should not say that, right? You have to disagree. But how do you disagree? You disagree in a very polite manner. You look at the professor with a lot of politeness and you politely say, sir, actually, I beg to differ with you on this, sir. I beg your pardon, sir, but I'm not a lazy person at all, sir. I'm a very hardworking person. I do a lot of other activities apart from studies also, sir. Right? So when you disagree in a very polite manner, gentle manner. Choice of words should be polite. I beg your pardon, sir. I beg to differ with you on this, sir. This kind of language shows to the professor that this boy, this girl is giving me respect. So choice of words should be polite. Tone of the voice should be very, very polite. Volume should be low when you are talking like this. Yeah. So that is how you show politeness in an interview. Never speak concurrently with any of the panelists. That also shows politeness. Friends, it is very important that you be honest in an interview. You should not lie. You should not claim false achievements when it comes to interviews. You have to be honest. Remember, nobody is perfect in the world. You may have done some misdeeds in the life. You may have had some failures in your life. It is absolutely fine to have failures. Trust me, the biggest difference when you go to business school for when you go for interviews in business schools compared with when you go to interviews which are conducted by HR people, there is a huge difference. In business schools, interviews are done mostly by teachers. Teachers, by definition, they never ever reject people who have had failures in life. Teachers love students who have got failures as long as those students have learned something from those failures. As long as those failures has improved them as a person. Teachers love those kind of students. So if you have had some failures in life, don't be afraid. Even if you share those failures, it is fine. For example, I have seen in my career a student who did his engineering in 7 years. I repeat, 7 years he took for completing engineering. This boy went on to join one of the very old IIMs of India. The fact of the matter is, in spite of completing engineering in 7 years, this person could make it to an IIM. The secret was, again, he had reasons, he had justifications, he had learned from the experience, and he moved on, and he is no longer the kind of person he was at that moment. So that is what you need to exhibit in an interview. And you should say that I have learned from my mistakes. I am much better now than what I was earlier. That is what the kind of attitude that they love to have. Friends, the last point in this particular slide is, do not panic if you are unable to answer a few questions. It's not a Kaun Banega Crorepati competition where you can't answer a few questions and you'll go home. Sometimes people don't answer 4, 5, 6 questions. But overall, the attitude that the person may have exhibited could be positive. If the overall impression is good, there is a very good chance of you getting selected as such. So just because you are not able to answer some questions, don't panic. Don't be nervous. Just try to answer every question to the best of your ability as the interview progresses. So usually the interview ends with the professors looking at the student and saying, okay, that's about it from my side. Any questions for us? This is a very polite way of telling to the candidate the interview is over. It's time to go home. So if you give a polite smile and say nothing, sir, it's absolutely fine to do that. But in case you say, no, I want to ask something. Can I ask something? Answer is yes, you can ask questions to the panel, provided your questions are sensible in nature. You don't ask senseless questions. Don't look at the panel and say, am I selected, sir? Sir, any tips for next interview, sir? How did I do, sir? These kind of questions you should not ask to the panel. They won't answer these kind of questions. Neither should you ask questions for which answer is very easily available on their website. If you go to IIM Bangalore and say to the panel, excuse me, sir, when was IIM Bangalore established? Obviously, IIM Bangalore professor would hate that because he would say, this guy doesn't even have interest to just visit my website and find information about my business school. So questions for which answers are easily available on the website should never be asked. For example, what kind of questions can you ask? Let's take an example. One of the students who was an excellent football player, he was asked this question. Any questions for us? This boy said, sir, as you know, I love football. I have represented my school and college during my school days and college days respectively. Sir, I was very happy. I went to the website of your business school and I found that your business school encourages sports. I saw on the website that your business school recently won a inter-college tournament. Sir, I was just curious to know, sir, if I'm selected, I just wanted to know the rules. Would only second year student represent the college, or first year students are also allowed to represent the college? Now, this kind of a question, even if the professor doesn't have the answer for it, it shows you in positive light. It shows to the professor that you are genuinely interested in joining them. You have taken out time and you have made an effort to know more about it. And of course, it shows a positive aspect of your personality. Professors obviously love sports people. Sportsman spirit is something that is invaluable that these people have in them. So if you ask these kind of questions, even if they don't know the answer, they would give a smile. They will look at you and say, okay, if you will know if you are selected. I agree with you. Our business school gives a lot of importance to sports. In fact, we did this, we did that, we did that. They'll give a answer to that. And they would say, I'm not sure of the answer, but anyhow, if you are selected, you will definitely come to know of it during the induction ceremony itself. So these kind of questions can be asked. But again, once again, if you don't have anything to ask, don't hesitate. Just give a smile and say nothing, sir, and move on as such. Now, friends, if you have got doubts, if you have got questions, if there are some other aspects that you believe I should have touched upon, if there are queries, you please send those questions to me. There's a provision of sending questions. It's available on your screen. Send them to me. I will try to answer some of the questions. Let me take a few questions that you people have posted. All right. Sushant has asked a question. Sushant says, do I need to know about the business school wherein I'm getting interviewed? Well, Sushant, that's a good question. Yes, you have to read a little bit about the business school where you are getting interviewed, because that shows that you are genuinely interested in joining the business school. For what information would they probably ask about the business school? For example, they may say, so who is director of our business school? Or what do you know about our business school? Now, when they say, what do you know about our business school? They don't like generic answers. Answers like, your business school is very good. I've heard very good things from my seniors. It's an awesome business school. It's my dream business school. This is not what they will appreciate. They will appreciate if you actually give them some facts, some information which you probably know because you are genuinely interested in joining them. Those are the kind of answers that they would appreciate. So read about the business school. Who is the director? When it was established? What are the major achievements that they have got? What are the different kind of clubs that they have on campus? What are the kind of placements that take place? When it was established? How it progressed from past as such, right? All this information will help you in conveying the message to the professor that you are genuinely interested in joining them. Okay, friends, this is again an interesting question. Shweta is asking a question. She says, sir, if I don't have any hobbies, is it okay to say I don't have any hobby? Well, Shweta, hobby need not be extremely, you know, it need not be an activity that is done very much regularly. It's not an activity that you do every day. But I would suggest, even if you are doing some activity occasionally and you can take questions on them, say that is your hobby. Because people who say, I don't have any hobby at all, I only go to college, come back home, and again go to college and come back home, the message that conveys to the panel is, here is somebody who cannot do multitasking. An MBA is all about multitasking. Managerial roles are all about multitasking. So please do not say, I don't have any kind of hobby. Is not the right kind of message to give in an interview as such. So even if you're doing some activity occasionally and you can take questions on them, as long as it's a positive activity, you can definitely say that's your hobby as such. But be prepared to take questions on them. Okay, this is this is a very common question. Aman is saying, what to do if I perform terribly in the section pertaining to academics? What should I do? See, Aman, if they are asking you questions from academics, let's take an example. Let's say, Aman, somebody is asking you questions from C language and they ask you 2, 3, 4 questions on C language and you don't know the answer and you keep on saying, I'm sorry, unable to recall. I'm unable to recall. I don't know. I'm unable to recall. It makes sense after 2 or 3 such questions, you politely give a hint to the panel that they should ask you questions about some other subject. So how do you go about doing that? You cannot say it explicitly. So politely, you can look at the panel and say, sir, actually, during my engineering days, I used to love C++. Now, better you know something about C++ when you say this. But if you believe you are much better in C++, you can say, sir, during my engineering days, I used to love C++. Now it's a indirect way of pleading to the panel that, sir, please ask me questions on C++, not C language. But now that you have said that you loved C++ in engineering days, you better have good amount of idea about C++, right? But if you do that, most of the time professors may shift to C++ and they may grill you on C++. Having said that, Aman, time is there. If you work hard in this remaining time, I'm pretty much sure you'll be able to do well across all the subjects. Some of you have posted me questions pertaining to business school selection. I will not answer those queries. This is not the right forum for it. Do participate in online chat sessions. Our chat schedule is available on timeforeducation.com. Participate in appropriate chat sessions and we'll definitely answer your questions pertaining to business schools also. All right, Prachi Jayaswal is asking me, sir, how to prepare for GK and current affairs? I'm very weak in it. Well, Prachi, you have already done the first right thing, which is to admit that you are weak in this area, which is good. But now that you have admitted it, now it's time to prepare hard on it. The best way of preparation for this would be, one, read newspaper on a regular basis, but more than newspaper, because newspaper will contain so much of data, so much of news. A better way of preparation for this is on your Time student homepage. Assumption I'm making is you're a Time student. If you're not a Time student, do register for GWPI program. And if you register for GWPI program, you will get access to something called as GWPI Briefcase. GWPI Briefcase is a tool available on student homepage of our students, which will give you enormous amount of information useful for your preparation. For example, one of the aspects of GWPI Briefcase is something called as Learner's Corner. Learner's Corner would have around a dozen links leading to very, very important articles related to current affairs. Right. So if you read those dozen articles or one and a half dozen articles, it will give you a very good amount of idea about current affairs at that particular moment. We keep on updating these articles. So it's not that the same dozen, one and a half dozen articles will always be available. We keep changing these articles every week, twice. Our experts change those articles, keep on uploading newer articles so that our students are well prepared to take questions on current affairs and general awareness. Apart from this, if you register for the GWPI program, we do weekend workshops in all major time centers. So in our weekend workshops, apart from doing mock GD, mock SA, mock PI sessions, we do a lot of seminars, knowledge sessions for a 3-4 hours duration. These knowledge sessions delivered by experts will ensure that someone like you, Prachi, would be able to take questions in interviews on general awareness and current affairs. Moving on. Okay. Interesting question by Vaidehi. Vaidehi says, how do I remain calm and cool in an interview if I'm getting, if I get panicked in the middle of interview, how do I remain cool? Well, Vaidehi, it's a question of your mental makeup. What I always suggest to my students is, before you walk into an interview cabin, one good way of remaining cool and calm, of course, is take a lot of mock PIs. The more number of mock PIs, good number of mock PIs you take. When I say more number, I don't mean to say you take mock PI every day. If you take too many mock PIs also, you will lose that spontaneity. But what I suggest is at least take 2 or 3 mock PIs in time. The reason I'm saying this is the experts in time, the faculty members in time, we have been training students for so many years, right? So when we have been training people for so many years, we have seen so many type of students. We have seen so much of feedback we have received from the students from business schools and so on and so forth. So we will ensure that you will be prepared for interviews and you'll not feel nervous on the day of interview. Secondly, before you walk into the interview cabin, one trick that you can use always is before you are, your turn comes, few minutes before that, just close your eyes and visualize some positive occasion from your life, some achievement that you had from your life. If you can relive that moment for a few seconds before you walk inside the interview cabin, you will be having a positive mindset and you'll not panic. Lastly, remember my advice. These people, they are just doing acting. Even if somebody is being a little impolite with you in an interview, remember, he's just a professional doing his job. And you should not panic. And remember what I said in the initial part of the session. Stress interview, it could be a stress interview. Just showcase good positive attitude. And I'm sure you will be able to come out with flying colors. But most important takeaway, take mock PIs. Attend mock PIs in time. That will help in your preparation. All right, one interesting question. Arun Kumar is asking me, sir, is it okay to ask the panel about mistakes that I have committed during the interview at the end of it? Well, Arun, frankly, what happens is most of the interviews don't have time to answer these kind of questions. and think about it. One, they may not answer. And two, if they answer also, you will not be uncomfortable. You will lose your confidence. Just imagine, Arun, you ask to the panel, sir, how did I perform, sir, any mistakes that I have committed? And let us say one of the panelists gives you a long list of mistakes that you have committed. What will happen to your confidence, Arun? You will panic. You will take it for granted that, boss, in this particular business school, I will never be selected. Right? And what will happen to your mental makeup before you go for the next interview? You lose confidence. If you have an interview coming up tomorrow, day after tomorrow, you will have absolutely no inclination to even go for the interview because of the feedback that you received from this professor. And most of the times, professors don't have time. So professors will sometimes give you a diplomatic smile and say, it's okay, ma, just work hard. Thank you. Now, this statement itself is a little misleading because if a professor says that, you don't know how to interpret that sentence. So better you don't ask these kind of questions at the end of interview. So friends, I hope you got an insight about how the process happens. Work on the feedback that I have shared with you. And trust me, as I have mentioned in my earlier slide also, this remaining period that you have got, a month, month and a half that you have got before you go for your business school interviews, this is good enough period to have a substantial improvement in your chances. Just work hard on the feedback. And if you have registered for GWPA program in time, attend classes regularly, work religiously on the feedback that my colleagues are sharing with you. And if you have not registered for the program, do so at the earliest, visit the nearest time office and register for the program. If you have received a call from any of the business school, do that very, very soon as such. All right. So I hope you enjoyed this webinar. My name is Asim Akhtar, and I wish you all the very best for all your future endeavors. Thank you, guys. God bless you.